Parag, thanks for talking to us. Clearly, we've seen a lot of upheaval in the last 6 months. But, just wanted to understand, let's say, from the, tire industry, do you see the market also coming back? Clearly, there's a lot of demand at the lower end where I think, you have a lot of presence. So, are encouraging signs for Bridgestone?
Hormaz, good to see you again. Happy to chat with you. And since we last spoke, of course, quite a few things have changed out in the market. Like you said, the whole tire industry or auto industry has been through a very, very dynamic time. I mean, when we last spoke, April, May was almost at a standstill. And right. There was really no demand for cars or for tires, for that matter. June, we started to see the replacement demand picking up. It picked up with the TBR or the truck side, where the logistics companies and the essential goods started getting shipped. So it picked up through that. Later, we also saw that the passenger car tires demand also picked up from July. And probably some of that can be attributed to the pent-up demand, the time when for 2 or 3 months all shops were closed.
Right.
And it continues to steadily grow. But what we have seen in most recent times now, especially in the last few weeks, is that the auto companies have ramped up their production, ostensibly in preparation for the festive season coming up. So we have seen the demand from all auto companies go up. And in fact, we are now ramping up our own production significantly to keep pace with both the OE as well as the replacement demand. So, as we stand today, I think the tire industry is coming back to normal at a pretty fast pace.
Great. So, and I think honestly, but just your sense also, I think the recovery, we've seen the volumes are happening at the lower end of the market. So clearly, that's where the bread and butter is, especially in the PV passenger vehicle, segments. Is that also an encouraging sign?
Yeah, so the mass market in India is still the 13-inch, 14-inch, to some Correct. Extent 15-inch tires. And obviously, there the demand has suddenly come back strongly. And some of it, I explained, was pent up. But also, I think people are now relying on personal transport much, much more. Right? So people who are not using their cars so much are starting to bring out and use their cars, and that they want to be safe. And that is the other trend we have seen. I think the safety and security is very, very important for consumers across all categories, true for tires as well. And that is driving some interesting behaviors in the consumers.
Right. And you talked about the mass market is still 13 and 14 inch. I mean, it's moving up. What is your sense? Do you see a gradual, OE upsizing as we go along, especially with the SUV market picking up? We've got vehicles like even now the Gloster coming in on 19-inch rims. It's at the slightly higher end, but still it's a mainstream product. What's your sense, or do you feel there's, given our road conditions, there's going to be a bit of a balance? I mean, we aren't going to accelerate towards lower profile tires as much as, in European markets or international markets. So, just your thoughts on the trends towards, the OEMs going upsizing in terms of rims and tires.
Yeah. So, this is a global phenomenon, the upsizing of rims. What we see in India, and which is also supporting this trend, is that the utility vehicles, CUVs, SUVs, MUVs, that is the fastest growing category. And that was true before the pandemic. And through the period of the last few months, we have continued to see that trend. In fact, the SUVs were the first category to come back to last year volumes. And as a given, they come with higher inch sizes. So definitely right. That is the trend. On the other hand, you also pointed out rightly that the Indian road conditions do not really support the low profile tires. So it will not be as exaggerated or accelerated as you see in Europe, where the road conditions are completely different from ours. So we'll see a gradual move towards higher inches driven by more SUV and utility vehicle usage, but it will not necessarily be the low profile tires.
Right. So, just sticking to our road conditions and the fact that we have moved towards low profile tires, to be honest, some manufacturers have also got a lot of complaints moving to 17-inch rims. We've heard this on the Innova Krista. We've heard this on EcoSports. You know, basically, it's down to the really thin sidewall where you get sidewall damage. So from a tire manufacturer, I mean, how do you design a tire for Indian road conditions? I would imagine you'd have thicker sidewalls, but that would compromise ride comfort to a certain extent. So just to get your philosophy on, let's say, you know, addressing these issues of sidewall damage, which is so prevalent in our country, given our road conditions.
Yeah, it is a big challenge, I would say, a big problem for consumers. Because quite often it happens, they buy new cars, they drive fast and hit a pothole or something, and you get the sidewall cut. And it's very difficult for them to understand as a layman that this is not a manufacturing defect. Because the first thing that comes to their mind is my tire is new, my car is new, how can it get cut so quickly? So first of all, I mean, all of us in the tire industry, we have a job to educate the consumers that right. With this low profiles and the bad road conditions, we have to be extremely careful when driving. Otherwise, it is going to result in the sidewall cuts. Of course, it's a loss to the consumer, but it could also be a safety issue. Having said that, we try to work right from the beginning of the supply chain. I mean, when the tires are being designed by the OE, we do try to share our experience of what happens out in the market and try to make sure that the tire design takes into account the fact that our road conditions are not good. And one way to do it, as you said, is to ensure stronger sidewalls.
But that would affect ride comfort to a certain extent. So there's a balance, a trade-off you'll have to work on?
Indeed, there is a balance and a trade-off. But all said and done, the Indian consumer or a large section of the Indian consumer, the most important thing from tires for them, first is safety, of course, and secondly is the life, the longevity. It's only a very, very small category of consumers who are very well-versed with the handling and the ride comfort and all of that. So the large consumer segment is looking at safety and longevity. So naturally, yes. the tire designs and the automotive company designs are leaning towards that end.
So that I think the sense one gets is Indian built tires, they would have maybe two ply sidewalls or, you know, rather than single ply. And that leads me to the other point. I mean, imported tires, clearly the imported tires don't have these kind of specifications for the Indian market. So, you know, I think I just wanted to ask you, is it really, are Indian tires unique to India or is it very similar sometimes to the spec in other markets with similar conditions?
So I can speak about Bridgestone. So we produce our, or we design and produce our tires suited to the local market needs. So if you're going to sell a tire in India, either to the OE or in the replacement market, that is designed from scratch, taking into account the Indian road conditions. And that applies to all markets. So Europe would be different, Middle East would be different, Latin America would be different. And we have what we call the road severity index, which is one very, very important parameter that goes into designing of the tire.
So when does India figure in the road severity index out of interest?
It is the most severe. It falls in the category of most severe.
Oh, really? Okay. That's interesting.
Yeah, because that also the fact that we have such a large country and such a big variety in the road conditions. On one hand, we could have the expressways, which are becoming more and more common in India, which are comparable to some of the advanced countries. But those same vehicles could travel to the rural areas where the roads are in a completely different shape. So when designing a tire, you have to take into account the variability of the roads as well. And therefore, I think the severity index, add to that the temperature variations that we get, you know, with the high summer temperatures, the monsoon conditions. So all that put together, I think we need to design tires to weather all of this.
So a tire design, I think for companies is a very, very complex balance of so many conflicting requirements. So just wanted to get your sense, what is being prioritized right now? Obviously, you spoke about durability, perhaps a little bit to over comfort. Prioritized over comfort. Now we even have low rolling resistance, which is being mandated coming when we have to meet CO2 targets. That also has its challenges, especially grip in certain conditions. So just wanted to understand, you know, what are the challenges and how do you balance all these conflicting requirements out? And Is there an order of priority you would put, because you can't have everything, the same?
Yeah. So there are challenges, and there are many different stakeholders who are making these demands. So you have the government, which is passing regulation, which mandates the rolling resistance because it affects the environment and the fuel consumption. You have the automotive companies who are looking at, of course, fuel consumption, but also at handling and comfort.
And then cost, you have, of course.
And cost, of course, and cost, of course. And then you have the consumers, who, there are many different types of consumers, but the large segment, if you can say, are looking at safety and are looking at long life. And the challenge is sometimes these things are conflicting, right? If you want to create a very, very long lasting tire, you will end up compromising on the rolling resistance, on the fuel efficiency. So all the efforts of tire companies, and especially of Bridgestone, is to come up with that golden mean, which can give you a very, very long life with safety, but at the same time, have fuel efficiency or a low rolling resistance. And constantly the boundaries are being challenged, and they're being challenged by, of course, the design components, but also the materials. So companies like ours work with materials, work with design components, work with tread patterns to draw an optimum balance between these two conflicting demands that are put on the tire. And I think over, if you look back last 10, 15 years, technology has moved, and we have constantly been able to do that successfully. But it does take a lot of effort, it does take a lot of investment, and it calls into account a lot of technical expertise. So I think global companies who have experience from multiple markets and who have seen this journey, we can draw upon that experience, and we can draw upon the heavy investments that we do in R&D across all our global R&D centers, and bring that to the Indian consumer as soon as the market is ready for that.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And but you know, you talked about the government regulations. Now there's a new regulation which I want to get your views on, where imported tires have been moved from open general license to the restricted list. Obviously, you know, this has come in the wake of all the issues which we've had, across the border. I mean, it's not really said so. And this whole kind of movement to look at more make in India, products and everything that we do. But clearly, this on certain sizes which are not available here, which are in small quantities, it's come as a big hindrance. I don't know what your view is on this. Is it something you would welcome? Is it something you're going to take advantage of? Maybe producing certain sizes which earlier were being imported. Just as an OEM or as a tire manufacturer with a strong manufacturing base in India, how does this regulation impact you all or even benefit you?
So, I mean, as you might know, more than 95% of the tires which are sold and used in India are locally produced.
Correct.
So to that extent, India is a very self-sufficient country when it comes to
tires. Did we need the tires to go onto the restricted list then? I mean, being OGL, it was still 95% produced.
It was. I think one loophole which could have been plugged, which has been plugged with this, is there was some amount of gray market tires coming in. These are tires which are produced in other countries, maybe in excess. They are not necessarily low quality or bad, but they are not designed for the Indian road conditions. And if they were being imported through the gray market with not the right duties being paid, then they are able to be sold in India at much lower prices. For the typical consumer, it's difficult to make to tell the difference between the two. So in a way, it's good that we have managed to close that loophole. And I talk about it from a safety point of view. If a tire is not designed and built for Indian standards, then it should not be allowed to ply on the Indian roads. So if we can block that loophole, that's great. And I think to some extent that has happened, because we see an increase in demand in that category. And this is the 13, 14, 15 inch categories where you used to see some volumes of that. So to that extent, I think it makes sense. It's not going to be a huge shift, I said, because 95% is anyway locally produced.
Right.
The challenge is, of course, the small volumes where the very, very high-end tires, where the car population in India is very low, the high-end cars, and it doesn't make economic sense to produce that in India. But our understanding is that if you make an application and you draw this justification, then licenses will be issued. It will increase some bureaucracy. It has increased some bureaucracy. It has created some time lag, but eventually I think it will be streamlined. So all in all, I think it will not be such a big impact on the tire industry locally. To some extent, it will close down this loophole I talked about, and that's a welcome move.
Right. So you see this as a welcome move.
Yeah. And we have, I mean, for us, it's almost 98% of the tires that we sell in India are produced locally. So it's really no big difference for us.
Right. So then this going back to, let's say, the bigger sizes, obviously, you know, for the higher end of the market, 17, 18, 19, certain SUVs, 20, 21, the imported ones. Is that a focus area for y'all, or do you see that, you know, it's too small a business to focus on? And, you know, unlike certain European competitors, which are really strong over there because they don't have too much of a manufacturing presence in India. So is that some area that you would look to get into, given the fact that, you know, there could be now an opportunity with these restrictions proving hurdles for, let's say, imports? Or let's say, as you said, just slowing down the process of imports.
Yeah, for sure it is a focus area, given that it is a small volume, but for two reasons it is a focus for us. One, it is the high-end car, so it is in sync with the brand positioning that Bridgestone has globally. Also, we believe that with our strong connects with these luxury OEMs in Europe and in other parts of the world, we are already working with them and designing tires for the OE fitments there. So it makes sense for us to make those tires available in India for the Indian consumers. And so that does not mean we don't continue to focus on the mass market. In fact, we can do both. And that has been our strategy over the last months, to increase our focus on what we call the ultra high performance tires.
Right. So,
and the restriction of imports, of course, to some extent it creates an opportunity. We have continuously upgraded our local manufacturing facilities so we can make more and more of them locally.
Right. And the last question, Parag, is, you know, let's say going forward, where do you see the demand going in terms of, you know, let's say for the tire industry? Clearly, I think, I don't think people are going to be putting up fresh capacity anytime soon. Do you see the opportunity for exports, or the fact that, you know, it's more domestic because our tire requirements are so unique only to this market? And which segments do you see growing and you focusing on going forward in the, let's say, in the next couple of years? I know hard to predict what's happening next week, but you know, still there, I'm sure some trends must be emerging.
Yeah, the macro trends which existed before this pandemic, I think they will continue. The penetration of automotive in India is still very low, and that was rising pretty steadily. I think that is going to continue. To some extent, for a short term, it might even be accelerated as many people will realize the importance of personal mobility and will put owning a car into their priority list. So I think in the short term, that will drive some demand. But longer term, India is still a long way away from some of the developed nations in terms of car penetration. So that is going to continue to grow. And we have bet on India for that, and we will continue to focus on that segment. The truck and bus segment is also growing. I mean, when the GDP starts growing and with the expected scrappage policy for vehicles coming in, we expect that the truck and bus segment will also continue to grow. These are the two segments that we are present in India, and we see that after a short lull, the macro trends will kick in again, and the segment will start growing steadily.
Right, but you don't see any requirement for additional capacity for a while right now.
So I think we spoke last time. We have been investing in capacity. Just last year, we brought on stream additional capacity in our Indore plant. So that is available for us to utilize.
So that's what I meant. So right now, your capacity requirements are met for the foreseeable future.
Indeed. And we have been on this investment spree from 2017. And we will continue in phases. So we don't see need for any things on top of that.
Parag, thanks very much for talking to us. Glad to see that, you know, things are a little bit more positive since we last spoke, and wish you all the best, and you know, hope to catch up soon again. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Varma. It's a pleasure talking to you.